In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God.
He said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover.
Oh, let's love the Lord. Let's give Him our very best right now. I worship You, Jesus. I worship You, Jesus. I love You. I magnify You.
Oh, God, I praise You.
I want You today, God.
Hallelujah.
I want what You have for me today, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank God. Amen. You may be seated. And thank you, Brother Garrett, for telling all the family secrets. I did eat better after I got a paycheck. And I guess it was a deal of pride. Didn't move to Fresno to mooch off everybody. Those guys were in construction, making in that day very good money, or especially as young as they were. And I was the new kid on the block. I was making barely minimum wage, trying to make ends meet. And I had not as yet received a paycheck. So I was really... had just a little bit of money left. Called my dad and said, I'm filling my gas tank up and I'm buying, I think, 2 pounds of pinto beans and a dozen eggs. And I made all the eggs into egg salad. And oh, I cooked all the beans. And I lived on egg salad and pinto beans till I got a paycheck. And it probably didn't smell the best, but I still like beans. I'm a beaner. I pastor a lot of Mexican folks, and they know I'm a bean eating man. I didn't get cured, and not too proud to say I still like it. Amen. But they didn't smell near as bad as the boots Brother Garrett cooked one day. That's another story. Amen. I am honored to be here, and I can't tell you how very, very much I appreciate the wonderful touch of God's presence that is here today. And God came last night, and I thank God for that. And to me, Ma, and Papa, I bring you greetings from the Wits, who will start revival with us on Sunday, and who have great regret at not being here. I think Brother Witt told me this is the first time your daughter has not been here for this meeting. Well, one of my daughters doesn't live with us any longer, and I know the feeling. That's something, these adjustments we make. But anyway, I bring you greetings, and I want to say thank you for the invitation. I sincerely appreciate it. Thank you for the room, the wonderful basket. Whoever put that basket together evermore knows what they're doing. And got up at 3 yesterday, had to catch a plane early, had to drive a couple of hours to get there, and had time to grab a sandwich before I got on the plane, and then it was crackers and peanuts, and didn't have a chance to eat before church. And so when I got to that room, that basket, I'm telling you, I had fun for just a few minutes there. I really did. And then to come to church and that wonderful food last night, that was ever more wonderful. Good to see so many of my friends. One of the wonderful things about this fellowship are the friends that we make. And I love this truth, love this gospel. There's nothing to compare to that, but I thank God for my friends. And appreciate the ministry. The ministry is a wonderful thing. It truly is. And I thank God for the wonderful and faithful saints of God. I really do. There's a lot of things said a lot of times about the ministry, but I thank God for the saints of God, and thank God for the precious saints of this local church. I doubt that you could put this together without the precious saints of God. Amen. And so I do appreciate all of you that are here. I trust that God is going to help us. And I will just say this, and this is not just speaking at random, but I sincerely mean it. Brother McMullen, just a little bit more, you could have made an altar call and we'd all been happy. Because I believe that we do need some worship. Amen. Very, very good. Thank God. To the word of the Lord, if you would stand with me. 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. I will endeavor to do my best today. If God comes in, I don't have to finish. I've got more notes than I normally carry. And but that doesn't mean I have to preach at all. If there is a place that God decides He wants to do something in here, then I am not above moving out of the way. Because that's what this is all about anyway. Hearing from God and allowing God to do what He would like to do. I do feel very comfortable here today. I thought last night, fellowshipping, observing, being in the service, I thought, I am so comfortable in these settings. And a number of years ago, I told my wife, I'm going to start branching out. I'm going to enlarge my circle of friends and start making preparations for a move that I knew was inevitable for me. And so I started visiting a number of meetings, different places, getting acquainted with a number of men. And everywhere that I went, I think I can honestly say everywhere that I went, I felt so good. I felt so comfortable. I felt this is what I am. This is what I enjoy being around. These are the kind of men I want to run with. And these are the kind of messages I like to hear preached. And I can only say that it's gotten better and better. I don't have to preach places. I'm happy just pastoring at home. I love the saints that God has given us. And I love the work of God. But I do enjoy getting to be around good men. Amen. Well, I feel God this morning.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. I knelt down here and there's a touch that came. And I'll just be honest. Most of the time, sometimes I've got to really work to get through some things. Probably at home it's because of all you've got on your mind and stuff you deal with. But I knelt down there and I'm telling you, God was here. God was here. And a tremendous touch, tremendous visitation of His presence. And I feel Him still. I feel good in this house today. Amen. Verse 26, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. Base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh, Brother McMullen, should glory in His presence. Holy Ghost, I love You. And I sense Your presence and I thank You. And You know, God, that I need You this morning. And I have a feeling we all feel that way today. There is a Holy Spirit in this place. And I'm asking you, God, to anoint me to bring your word. Your word is anointed. But help me in my involvement in getting your word across. Help me, God, today. Help this people today. Let your presence, let your spirit flow. Give us, Lord, what we need. Work on me. Help me today, God, and I will be very, very thankful for your touch and for your presence. Amen. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. I love my pastor. I'm not ashamed to say that. And 1976, on June 4th, I moved into an apartment with Brother Garrett. Brother Morton became on that day my pastor. My dad had previously been my pastor. And four things, basically. I mean, he's taught me so many things through the years, and I'm still learning, ever learning, hopefully coming to the knowledge of greater truth. But four things that I could say readily and lay my hands on pretty quickly that I feel like my pastor has put in me. Number one is prayer. The need for prayer, continued prayer. And that's always something very, very important. Evangelism. Reaching out. Do whatever you can. You're going to reap a harvest from the soul in a lot of areas, but you can reap a harvest from a lot of areas. So prayer, the harvest. And holiness within and holiness without, and that's important that we view it in that regard. And I want that. And then our pastor has talked a lot about a right spirit. Those are the four key things that I had to lay my hands on, something very quickly that I feel like my pastor tried to put in us as first of all, saints, and secondly, as young preachers. And even today, not that long ago, I received a letter from him and admonishing us in some of these same areas. He wrote a letter to all of the men out from under his ministry. But prayer, evangelism, holiness within and without, and a right spirit. And I thank God for every one of those things, because I feel like in this day and age that those are the critical things that a man's got to get a hold of. There are a lot of other things in life that we may strive for, a lot of other things that we're interested in. And not just preachers, but saints. Those are areas, key areas, that we need to endeavor to get a hold of some things in God. And God, in His omniscience, in His wisdom, He has known from the beginning what the key elements that godly men are going to need. Another look at the church, Brother Jordan, is very, very good. And I believe that God is interested in that. There are some things that will never change. There are some things that, in God's mind, He has always desired for His people. There are some things that God, in His wisdom, He placed in the heart of men very early on. Abraham in worship. And Noah, early on, taking a stand irregardless of what the world around him was doing, so much so that it caused him to find favor and grace with God while the rest of the world was going to be destroyed. There are things that God has expected of mankind from the beginning. There are things that God has, I think, in the beginning, in the garden, it was probably intrinsic. It was inherent. They just knew spending time with God is what this is all about.
All right.
Knowing God, walking with God, understanding that this thing called life is really more about spending time with Him. In the beginning, I believe that's what it really was all about. Then about getting to do a lot of other things in life. And all through the scripture, you can find incidences, and you can certainly find men where it would appear that God laid His hand upon them in a special way. When you search a little deeper, you will find that generally the reason God had laid His hand upon them is that somewhere in their life, there was a getting alone with God. There was a walking with God. There was a relationship. There was something that was developed. And sometimes it may have come to them seemingly in a hurry. And then it continued on. And other times they kind of grew into it. And the understanding maybe was a little slower in developing. But finally it was there. And they recognized that this is where it's at. And we find many men in the scripture, early scripture, that we could point out. Noah, Enoch, obviously, Abraham, later on, Jacob. We know that Moses had a tremendous walk with God, and later on became, in fact, today is still thought of as the greatest prophet in Israel among the Jews. And one after the other, then you get to Samuel. The child who was not, but because of prayer and burden, he was. And he came to birth as a result of a woman who took a man seeking God seriously. And we know that he was given to the Lord from youth. If you will bear with me today, I will not preach fast. And I don't feel in that praise mode today. Elder McMullen, I feel more of the worship mode today. I really do. But we know that Samuel, we know of his birth. We know that Hannah prayed and prayed until probably she had no more words to speak. And she stayed there and her lips were moving and yet there was no voice that came out. We know that Eli marked her mouth, and whether that means he backhanded her or whether or not it means he just observed, there's something really happening in this woman. And he marked her, and then he prophesied over her that at the appointed time that she would be a mother. And then she promised God, "I'll give him to you." And that is one thing for a parent to say. And most of us have dedicated our children to the Lord, but that does not mean that the heart of those children are going to be in what you had wanted for those children. And but Samuel caught it. He got a hold of it. And his mother lent him to the Lord and dedicated him to the Lord. And somehow it took. Somehow it got in him. And he said, "Yes, this is what I want." And when he was weaned, and we don't know what age that was, 3, 5, 12, we don't know where that was, but somewhere in there, she took him by the hand and took him to the man of God who had prophesied over her, and she delivered that son to the man of God and said, "I am giving him to the Lord." And no doubt she expected Eli to put the right things in him. I am sorry to say that Eli did not always put the right things in him, but because there was a hunger. And perhaps he learned it at home before he ever moved into the temple or the tabernacle. But wherever it was, somehow there was something in that young boy that was very interested in what God was doing. He was concerned and he took it to heart. The ministry of the tabernacle and the things of God. We know that Samuel was a man that became acquainted with God. He was a man that from very early on, he was acquainted with God's house and the ministry of God's house. We know that Samuel was acquainted with God's voice at a young age and didn't recognize it initially, but once he caught on, boy, he evermore recognized and knew the voice of the Lord. We know that he took time for personal devotion. In fact, it became something that came on him that Samuel became known as a prophet in Israel. And he had a bearing about him. And we're going to see that there were some things about him that I'm telling you, he could make people uncomfortable at times. There was something about him. He was dedicated. Samuel was a man committed to prayer. He said, 1 Samuel 12:23, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you, and I will teach you the good and the right way. To Samuel, a lack of prayer would have been sinful. It meant as much to him to go to prayer as it meant to Joseph. To remain a man of integrity and a man of moral purity. When Joseph said, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He just could not go that far. Well, Samuel's prayer was the same way. I can't sin against God in failing to pray. It meant something to him to get in the presence of God. He understood that it's an awesome thing for the Almighty to come and for God to visit me and for God to come and for God to overshadow me. What an honor that it was. I would submit to you today that it's still an honor for God to come. I would bring to you today, amen, somehow that God, if God will visit us, oh, how blessed we are. If God just shows up, oh, how blessed we are. Amen, to walk into His house or to walk into your prayer room at home, to close the door, to raise your hands or fall on your knees, to spread abroad your hands and begin to whisper that name, Jesus, Jesus, and have God show up. There's nothing that compares to that. I'm telling you, there's no greater joy in this life than that God just shows up, that God comes on the scene, that God would visit us with His glory and His grace. Hallelujah. Amen. 1 Samuel 16:4, the bearing of this man is very evident by this verse. The Bible says the elders of Bethlehem trembled at his presence. He walked in, and because he walked with God, they didn't know what to expect. They didn't know whether he was going to come in and call fire down from heaven. They didn't understand, and he had prayed thunder and lightning before. He had prayed and that God show us your power and reveal to us your great glory. And Samuel prayed a prayer that thunder and lightning fell. Not just Moses, but Samuel had that kind of a walk with God. And so Samuel comes on the scene, and the elders of Bethlehem, they're trembling. The Bible says in 1 Samuel 12:18, all the people feared the Lord and Samuel. They didn't only fear the Lord, they feared Samuel. In spite of their fear, though, there began to be something in the heart of the people. Now bear with me for a little while today. You're listening and I appreciate it, but we've got a ways to go here. They feared the Lord and they feared Samuel, but nevertheless, the people began to say, we want a king. 1 Samuel 8:5, now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. That was the heart of Israel. Somehow they had begun to wander in their mind and wander in their heart. 1 Samuel 8:19, nevertheless the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel and they said, nay, but we will have a king over us. Samuel was the people's choice, or Saul was the people's choice. 1 Samuel 12:13. Now therefore the king, behold the king whom ye have chosen, whom ye have desired. They tired of Samuel. They tired of a man of God. And what a walk that man had, and what a touch of God that he had. But the people of God, they began to allow things to come into their heart that made them desire, I want to be like other nations. And I don't want to get too sidetracked. I do have a place to go today. But let me just, amen, pause right here to say, it's a sad day when the people of an apostolic church start looking around. And begin to desire to be like other people. And I could really get sidetracked here, but let me just go a little bit further Amen. When they begin to look around them and say, I not only want to be like the world, or I want to be like other worldly churches. It's a sad day. That's not a good day. That's not a good time. That's not a good sign. Amen. Would to God the heart of the people could be linked up with a Samuel. Could be linked up with a man of God. Could be united. Amen. With the mission that says, my man of God, he knows God. He knows how to touch God. He knows how to pray. He's got a vision from God. If they join arms, if they join hands, if they join hearts, if they catch his vision, if they say, lead the way, Pastor, we're ready to follow. It's interesting that God, he allowed Israel to have the king of their choosing. That was not God's plan. That was not God's design from the beginning. We know the Lord told Samuel, they've not rejected you, they have rejected me. They are not following the way that they had been. And so we are going to give them a king. And we're going to do our best by that king. I will do everything I can. I'm paraphrasing. But I'm going to do my best by that king, Samuel. But we're going to give them what they want. We know that the people found Saul. And there were several things about Saul that were probably admirable. And we know that Saul, when he was young, the Lord made him, or when he was little in his own sight, the Lord made him king over Israel. The scripture teaches us that. We know that the Lord, he allowed Samuel to anoint him with the same oil that he later anointed David with. And that is very, very admirable and precious. But we find some other things about Saul that it doesn't take very long until you begin to recognize there's something in this man that is so far different from what Samuel had. He is king only 2 years, and as he is reigning now, he's the Bible said when Saul was king a year, and then it says when he is king 2 years, that this is what happened in that year, that Saul was supposed to wait upon Samuel, the man of God, and he was going to offer sacrifice before going to battle at the appointed time. But Samuel was a little delayed for whatever reason, the scripture does not tell, and Saul, he's at Gilgal, and so Saul offers up a sacrifice. It is upon that scene, after the sacrifice has been offered up, that Samuel appears, and he says, what have you done? You weren't supposed to do this. You're getting ahead of everything. And that's the problem. He got ahead of everything. It began to weigh too much upon him. He was king 2 years there, and then when Saul had been king about 8 years, the Bible tells us he built his first altar. The first time he offered the sacrifice at Gilgal, he was no doubt using an altar that had been built by Samuel or a godly man before him. And 2 years into his kingdom, he's borrowing an altar. And 8 years into his reign, he is building his own altar. We begin to see something here that is developing, that is going to tell us why the man never could be what God wanted him to be. He was 16 years into his reign when God spoke to Samuel and sent him back and said, I want you to go down to Amalek, and I want you to take care of Agag and destroy all the people and everything that was there. And so he went down there, but he didn't heed the voice of God, allowed Agag the king to live, and allowed the best of the sheep and the oxen to live. And somewhere in the heart of this man, though he was little when it all started, in his own eyes he was small, but somewhere things begin to go on a decline. 2 years I'm going to offer a sacrifice on somebody else's altar, even if it means I'm out of place. 8 years into his reign, he says, well, I'll finally get around to building an altar. 16 years into his reign, he says, I don't really care that God wants me to do all of this. I think I can choose my own way and do exactly what I want to do. We know that the judgment of God came upon him in 1 Samuel 15. We understand that that Samuel came to him and began to rebuke him and told him that your stubbornness and your rebellion is as witchcraft. We know that 40 years into Saul's reign, the decline is very, very great, and that sometimes it can be very gradual. But when you get to the end of his life, in his 40th year, he is actually visiting a witch. The witch, the woman with the familiar spirit of Endor, he never got that spirit out of his heart. He never got that rebellion out of his heart. He never, amen, got a hold of what the altar was really supposed to mean. He never got a hold of what true worship was really supposed to be all about. And he told his servants, you find me a woman with a familiar spirit, and I will go to her. And he said that I may go to her, that I may inquire of her. I'm not interested in God. God's not listening. Oh, but there was a day, sir, when God would have listened. There was a day, sir, when God gave you every opportunity and every chance. In fact, when you read 1 Samuel, I believe it's chapter 8, God tried hard. After Samuel had anointed Saul, the Bible said God gave him another heart. But it's one thing for God to touch a man, and it's another thing for that man to latch on to it. It's another thing for that man to say, I'm going to hold to this touch that God's trying to give to me. Two places the scripture says this. 1 Samuel 9:2, 1 Samuel 10:23. The Bible talks about Saul's height. It says, from his shoulders and upward, he was higher than any of the people. One of the most, I guess, noticeable things, the thing that stands out the most about Saul, he was a big man. From his shoulders and up, he was higher than any of the people. Seems to me that Saul, in the scripture, there's a lot of attention that is paid to his head. There's a lot of attention that's paid to his height, to his head. Brother Garrett has already made reference to it. But for Samuel 13:4-14, after Saul had offered that sacrifice, Samuel comes. This is what he said. But now the kingdom, thy kingdom shall not continue. For the Lord hath sought him a man after his own heart. Two chapters later, the same day that made the men, the elders of Bethlehem, tremble, Samuel appears to Jesse, and he's looking for a man. The sons begin to pass by one by one. Samuel wanted to, but felt checked. No, this is not it. This is not it. This is not where it's at. And the Lord said, you're looking on the countenance. You're looking on the stature. Or you're looking just like you did on Saul. You're looking at his face. And you're looking at how tall he is. You're looking at his stature. But the word of the Lord goes on to say, I'm looking on the heart. I'm looking on the heart. I'm looking for somebody that's got a heart for the things of the Spirit. I'm looking for somebody that I can relate to on a spiritual level.
Oh my God.
I'm looking for somebody that I can reach, that I can commune with. I'm looking for somebody that's going to fulfill the role that I originally intended for mankind to fulfill. Adam knew it. Enoch knew it. Abraham knew it. Samuel knew it. There were others. I'm looking for another man
yes.
that understands what I really want.
All right. Yes.
I'm looking for somebody that really knows what serving me is all about.
All right.
Jesus. I'd like to pray for just a minute here.
Hallelujah.
Let's all pray for just a moment. I love you, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. Come on, let's pray for just a little bit. I love you, Jesus. I worship. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I have to believe the Lord was pleased when He heard David say, "One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life." I have to believe the Lord was pleased with it. I have to believe that the Lord was pleased when David said, he began to talk about in the 23rd Psalm, "Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
Yes.
You do know you've got to go a long way in Scripture before you ever find anyone that really just says these words to the Lord. I'm telling you, you've got to go a long way. You go from Genesis 1 and 1. You go all the way. I'm not saying no one ever said it, but you don't find it in Scripture where they use these words. From Genesis 1 and 1, you go all the way to Psalm 116. Amen. To where a man finally says, "I love the Lord. I love the Lord. I love the Lord." I'm telling you, that's a long time. That's a lot of years, brother. That's a lot of time that's passing. But it's not recorded by any one man that stood up and said, "I just love God. I don't do this for any other reason. I'm doing this because I love Him. I do this because I want to worship Him. I love Him. I love Him. Evening, morning, and at noon." He said it. "Will I pray? Evening, morning, I love God. I love God." Let's pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm preaching this morning on this thought, and that is, what makes men great? What makes men great? David said, "I will praise Thee, O Lord, with my whole heart."
All right.
And I believe David understood that praise encompasses deeper things than just jumping and shouting, and we do that.
Yeah.
And David, he understood a lot about consecration. He understood a lot about the deeper things of God. Most of the Psalms were written by him, and no doubt as a result of consecration. No wonder the Bible called David a man after his own heart, who is a man whose motives, whose desires were hungry for the things that flow deep. I just want to be with God. I want to move of God. I just want to say something here. We live busy lives.
Yeah.
There's so much to do. There's so much to do. Business, children, families, there's so much to do. I'm afraid sometimes consecration can be relegated to the back shelf.
All right.
And consecration really is the most important thing we do.
Yes. Right. Amen. All right.
We've got have to run churches, businesses, you work, go to school. All important, but nothing to compare to consecration. It doesn't measure up. Consecration is a time that God and man go back on that original level of intent. God and man going back to God's ultimate desire. I want you to spend time with me. Consecration, a time when man bears his soul to God. And you can do it with him, brethren. I wouldn't bear my soul to just anybody. I wouldn't share the secrets of my soul with just anybody. But you can share them with him. Spending time with God. Spending time in prayer, spending time in devotion, and good things happen. And God blesses. And there's a touch. I've been preaching a lot about revival at home. In fact, the last 2 months, I don't think I've preached a message other than revival preaching. The focus primarily on revival in the last 2 months. Now there are seasons I'll get into a deal and I'll teach holiness and prayer or whatever. But it's been revival and not just treetop tall shouting revival. It's let's go deep. And preaching revival and having a revival church. It's been beating in me. But when you boil it all down, having a revival church really means having a consecrated church.
Right.
Right. Right.
Having revival church it boils down to people making prayer and spending time with God a priority. You're not shouting today, but I knew you wouldn't. That's not the intent of this message. Amen. There is a depth. Can I just say it? There is a depth that is missing. And I'm going to use this in a general term. But in the apostolic church, there is a depth that is missing. Now there are some individual and specific churches that is running very deep. But there is a trend right now towards shallowness. We are living in a time, we're living in a day when shallow is all right. And you can call it good church if you can get those ivories moving good enough. And those cymbals are moving just right. And the thump of the bass is just right. And we can call that high church. And I want to tell you, I think high church sometimes, Brother McMullen, is like this. High church sometimes is going to be loud church. We shout, we run, we're too loud sometimes, but But that's not the highest church. High church is deep church. High church is knowing God. High church is somehow creating an atmosphere. And oh, this is where I'm afraid sometimes. We stand in danger of losing it. Amen. Bringing up children and young people in an atmosphere that is only filled with hype. It's going to skew their understanding of what a move of God is. It's thrilled me when I've heard my son say, and he's a preacher in his own right, and God's blessed him, and I'm thankful. But I've heard him say, Dad, and he'll tell me about a place or a service or whatever, and growing up, the things that he remembers the most is not the shouting at a conference, but it's the preaching, like Brother Garrett does, some others, that'll put a man on his face. Find his way back behind the platform, scoot up under the bleachers or wherever you're at, under a chair, under a pew, and lay there. You cry, you pray it out, and young men dig out a consecration. Amen. And let me just say this, and that's a conference that men of God are never made in conferences.
Right.
No. There'll be no men of God made in this week. All right. You may receive some inspiration in a conference, but men of God are made in closets. It's that alone time, brother. It's that going back to God's original plan of intent. Man, spending time with me. Man, getting alone with me. Man, finding me. Man, making me their number one priority.
Oh, God. That's right.
Oh, hallelujah.
Somebody said, I want to be a man of God. That's noble. That's a noble desire. Do you understand there's a lot of loneliness in that? You understand there's a lot of lack of fellowship to ever get there. Somehow, if you ever do get there, it's going to be because you sacrificed some time and spent some time with God. Saul never made it to the point of consecration as far as we can ever tell. We find no record. We find no psalms, no songs. In fact, he is so troubled by evil spirits. They called for David to play and create atmosphere. The evil spirits would stop troubling him. But you never find Saul ever learning how to create that atmosphere that was wholesome and healthy. You never find him setting the example of spirituality for his children, offspring. In fact, later David was so thrilled the Ark of the Covenant's coming. He jerks his jacket off. He's dancing. He's elated. And Saul's daughter, David's wife, is home, skeptical, cynical. What kind of church are you trying to have around here? And David said, baby, I just got to tell you, you didn't like that. You probably won't like the service we're going to have tomorrow either. Because I'm not about to stop. This is not a matter of just being seen. You don't know. What you don't understand, sweetheart, is this didn't start when that golden box started walking down the road on the shoulders of those priests. This started back there in the woods. This thing started a long time ago. I was out there all by myself. I didn't have anybody else to talk to. And furthermore, sometimes I didn't even want anybody else to talk to. This started a long time ago. And what you see in me today, sweetheart, is not new. This is carryover. This is not something I do. This is something I are. I've been doing it a long time. Amen. And so, you don't find that in Saul. I don't even know how long I've been preaching. But you do find it in David. All David's life, it's like he continues to climb. It's an ascension. And everything you find about God, men turning to God, he asked us, Jeremiah said, Lamentations, lift up your heart with your hands. The word of the Lord teaches us to lift up our eyes. In fact, David said it, I will lift up mine eyes into the hills from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. Lift up your head, Jesus said. Everything about God is to help us ascend.
Yes. Right. Right.
Hands, heart, eyes, lift up your voice. It's to help us ascend. It's to look up. The only place you find a decline in David's steady climb was in 2 Samuel chapter 11. At the time when kings go forth to battle. David tarried still at Jerusalem, but it wasn't for time of consecration. And he lost it. He lost it. And this is not a comfortable subject to broach in any setting. And I will do my best to be as discreet as possible. But I want to tell you something, brethren. Men fall.
Right.
And none of us are above falling.
Right. That's right. That's right. You're right. You're right.
In fact, the only way we will refrain from falling is if we go back to worship. And have seasons of consecration. And have seasons of spending time with Him. Because consecration drives away carnality. At least it abates it. It holds it off. It keeps it from getting a hold on us. Paul said, I die daily. And it's a good thing he did. Because had he not, he would have probably, as passionate as he was, he would have probably been somebody you couldn't even fellowship with. And he recognized that in himself there dwelleth no good thing. Romans chapter 7. He understood there's not a lot of promise in me. And when you feel, if all you read was through Romans was through chapter 7, that book would have ended so depressed. But thank God for chapter 8. There is therefore, making reference to what had just been said in the previous chapter, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the life of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. I'm here to tell you, the answer, brother, the answer, sister, is we've got to get in the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. We just had foot washing at communion recently, and a week of consecration. I did it different this year. We broke our fast the last night of our consecration with communion, but I thought, this year we're going to do foot washing the night before. And I've taught it, I've preached it a lot of different ways, but I begin to see things in this that I've not seen before. You've probably seen it. I'm just slow. But we know that foot washing is a type of humbling of ourselves. Jesus did it as the Lord and Master humbled Himself, washed the disciples' feet. We believe that it's very important. We believe, I teach, you can't be saved without it. You have to work, you have to miss, or you're sick. We understand that. But you can't miss it because you're too proud to wash somebody's feet. Or you have no part of it. That's my teaching. That's Hyler's doctrine. We believe in communion. I believe we ought to do it till Jesus comes. But I also believe that in doing that, it's a type. We're partaking of the blood and body of Jesus Christ. We're all on the same page there. And but I also see it as a sign of submission.
Yes.
Jesus taught. He taught humbling, and he taught submission. When he went to the garden, he went there to submit himself. Father, not my will, but thine be done. Philippians 2, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, but took upon him the form of a servant, and humbled himself, and became obedient unto death. In foot washing and communion, there is a humbling and a submission. There is in worship, Brother McMullen, forgive me for piggybacking so much, but there is in worship a humbling and a submission that brings us into sweet communion. And until there is a humbleness, and until there is a total submission, you do not have the sweetest of communion.
You are right.
All right. All right. Right.
That communion with Jesus, partaking of His blood and His body, to do it right, it's going to come through. I'm going to submit myself, God, to whatever. I just taught this to our church. I'm submitting myself, God, to whatever you want me to do. And whatever you want me to be. Let's pray. God, I love you. I worship you. I'm seeking your favor, God. I'm seeking your favor. I love you. I worship you. I praise you. I exalt you, Jesus. I magnify your name. I worship. I worship. Let's come. Could we really worship Him for just a little bit? Let's all lift up our hearts. Let's lift up our voice and pray for just a few moments here. I love you, Jesus. I worship you. I lift you up. I magnify you. I exalt you, Jesus. I exalt you, Jesus. I love you, Lamb of God. I love you, Jesus. Thank God. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and His train filled the temple. And above it stood the seraphim, each one having six wings. With twain He covered His face, with twain He covered His feet, and with twain He did fly. And one cried unto another, saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with His glory. Isaiah, you've got your eyes on Uzziah, but if you ever get your eyes on Jesus, things going to be different. Now there's a reason he had his eyes on Uzziah. Uzziah was evermore in his day the king. In fact, if you'll search his life and study it, you'll find there were few that ever even measured up to where Uzziah was at. He was very wealthy, but he was an inventor. He was ingenious in strategies of warfare. But the scripture has this to say about him. This is how he got his blessing. And if you don't think it is, you've got to read the rest of the story. 2 Chronicles 26:5. And he sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God. And as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. As long as he sought the Lord, God said, I'm going to bless you, son. As long as you're on your face, I'm going to do good things for you. As long as you remember that you were nothing when I found you. As long as you remember this, Uzziah, your daddy started out well, but the last 15 years of his life, he failed. Your grandpa did the same thing. Your great-grandpa did the same thing. You've got to go back to your great-great-grandpa, Jehoshaphat, before you find a king that started and ended right. Uzziah, don't fail to understand. As long as you seek the Lord, there's going to be prosperity coming your way. You're going to be blessed. You're going to have revival in the kingdom. You're going to grow. God's going to do good things for you. And so he learned that and he followed that. But somewhere in his heart, something changed. His success caused something to happen in him. He reached a comfort level, perhaps to where he said, I don't need God as much. Don't think preachers can't get there.
All right.
Our churches are small. We're struggling to pay bills. We're struggling just to keep the doors open. And after a while, brethren, we're not careful. We don't need God as much. Or that attitude could come to us. Amen. As long as you sought the Lord, he prospered. I want to tell you, saints. Amen. Sometimes when you're young and you're barely making it. Amen. You can pray every day because you need God so much. But God blesses you at the business and your business starts doing good. You may reach an attitude somewhere that says, I don't need God as much. Don't do it. You still with me? I need to land this thing. Later on in that same chapter, verse 15, the Bible said his name spread far abroad. For he was marvelously helped till he was strong. His name was spread abroad, for he was marvelously helped till he was strong. But when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction. For he transgressed against the Lord, his God. When he was strong, his heart was lifted up. And it destroyed him. The man that was made by his consecration now ends up dying in a several house. A leper, because he got bigger in his own mind than what he was supposed to. And he got in dire, dire trouble. There is a verse in several verses in 1 Chronicles chapter 12. And the children of Issachar, now this is when the kingdom of Israel, remember, Saul dies, Judah makes David king in Hebron. And but now all of Israel is coming. And they're coming little by little. Some are coming with greater numbers, some are coming with others. But the men that are coming with this in their heart. And I want you to catch this. And I will try to land this here shortly. The children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times. And this is a message all in its own. To know what Israel ought to do. Verse 33 of Zebulun, such as went forth to battle, expert in war with all instruments of war. And it gives their number and says, which could keep rank. They were not of double heart. Of the Danites, expert in war. Of Asher, such as went forth to battle, expert in war. Goes on and talks about others that were capable in all manner of instruments of war for the battle. It says all these men of war that could keep rank came with a perfect heart to Hebron to make David king over Israel. There was something in them that caused them to be expert in war. And it's one thing to be expert in war, but it's another thing to know how to keep rank. And it's another thing not to be a double heart. And all of these things are in this chapter. And it's another thing to have a perfect heart. It's one thing to be expert in knowing the mechanics of what we're doing. It's another thing to be able to keep rank. It's another thing to do it and not have a double heart. And I could stop and I could preach here for just a little while on motives, on why we do what we do. And somebody needs to preach on that. Amen. Why we do the things we do. God, help me not to have a double heart. Help this to come out of my spirit. I want to do the right thing for the right reason. Amen. I'm preaching about what makes men great. What makes men great? And the ability to be great in God must also involve the ability to humble oneself. The ability to be great in God must also involve the ability to submit oneself. The ability to be great in God must always involve a place in our heart to make room for consecration. And our families are depending on it. And our churches are depending on it. And power-packed churches, amen, come because of people that have a consecration. And the gates of hell are thwarted because people are consecrated. Amen. There's two things that we've got to be careful of, brethren. Amen. We've got to be careful of a lack of consecration. Amen. We've got to be careful of getting so busy that we lose our consecration. And the next thing we've got to be careful of is ambition. Amen. And you can still have a measure of consecration and still have ambition. You can be ambitious and still have a prayer life. And you cannot afford to allow your ambition to shadow your consecration. You can't afford to allow your desires for success and numbers and growth to overshadow that longing that says, God, this is not about me. This is about you. Shall we stand?
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. In 1787, Edward Gibbons, writing The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, he gave the following list as reasons for that fall. The rapid increase of divorce, the undermining of dignity and sanctity of the home, which is the basis of human society. Higher and higher taxes, the spending of public money for free bread and circuses for the populace. The mad craze for pleasure, sports becoming every year more exciting and more brutal. The building of gigantic armaments when the real enemy was within, the decadence of the people. The decay of religion, faith fading into mere form, losing touch with life and becoming impotent to guide the people. What he's really saying is, when they moved away from the basics, the things that made them great, they lost it all. It went into ruins. It declined. It fell. May I submit to you today, this afternoon, if we ever get away from the basics, in pursuit of success and grandeur and numbers and acceptance, there's a lot of areas we could go, brethren. There's a lot of time that could be spent on all of this stuff. But if we ever move away from it, they'll be writing about the decline and the fall of the apostolic movement.
You're right.
And if we could just break it down a little bit more personal, I pastor Landmark Tabernacle in Atwater, California. If our people, and it starts with their pastor, ever get away from praying and seeking God and real worship, they're going to be talking about, well, that used to be a church. They're going to be talking about Brother Hyler, boy, he used to really hold a straight line. They could talk about it, though. You put yourself in that slot there, the decline and fall of whatever local apostolic. I want to tell you something. It boils down to consecration, brethren. It boils down to knowing God and walking with Him, because when we've got that going, this other stuff can't get in. If our people, if my people that I pastor, that God's blessed me to be able to pastor, if they're consecrated, I'm not worried near as much about internet. I know that's the sacred cow, but that's right. If they're living consecrated lives, I don't have to worry about them having internet if they don't need it. Or keeping a block on it. And being accountable. Now I know that's good preaching. I know that's right preaching. If our people are consecrated, I don't have to worry about sleeve lengths and necklines and hemlines. When they're consecrated. When they're consecrated, they hear the preaching. It's when they start losing their consecration that it's easy for them to miss church. And they're not hearing it anymore. Or they're coming, but their heart is far from God. Samson, what are you doing? Where are you going? I'm going back to her house. Samson. She's not what you are. Yeah, but I don't feel as strong about my consecration as I used to. Don't go there, Samson. Something's going to happen. And he visited and she worked on it. And he visited and she worked on it. And he's laying his head in her lap. You know, brethren, it really all boils down to his failure came. It's so simple. Because he finally gave up his consecration. He was consecrated to be a Nazarite. We're different, Samson. We live consecrated lives. I know Mom. I know Dad. But my consecration doesn't mean today what it used to mean. Samson, it could only mean one thing, man. You're not far from failure.
Help, Lord. Help, Lord. Help, Lord.
And I've preached long today. I know I have.
That's right.
But I want to tell you something. The apostolic church of this day, we need some men that know what Israel ought to do. And yes, I know that means some definite direction, but does that also include consecration and worship? I'm going to ask us all to gather in here this morning. And I'm going to ask us to begin to seek the face of God. And I'm not asking you to stay all afternoon. But I'm asking if we can get a hold of something this morning. God, count me in and on consecration. Count me in, God, on worship. Count me in, God, on spending time with you. I love you, Jesus. I worship. Hallelujah. Could we make new consecrations this morning? Jesus.
Books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
When they heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins.